Wow, what an offseason for Orange County Soccer Club. What was it? A returning head coach that was a fan favorite. A massive amount of key players returning. I think the most in team history. Oh, and almost 1,500 new owners with a club as part of the investment opportunity that the club opened up at the end of last season. We're excited about this. Let's talk about it. Welcome to the Podcast of Champions. This is the Orange and Black Soccer Cast. How's it going, Orange County? Welcome to another episode of the Orange and Black Soccer Cast, the first and only podcast dedicated to Orange County Soccer Club, its fans and supporters. I'm your host, Ray Samora, and I'm going to take you through our journey as we discuss all things Orange County Soccer Club. Helping me out with this journey for this episode. First, we got Brad. Brad, how's it doing? Happy 2024.
Happy 2024. What a long off season it has been, and yet we still got another 3 weeks to go.
We do, and it's exciting. I'm ready for this. I want the season to start right now, but it's not quite there yet. Also helping us tonight, or for this episode, we've got Mr. Larry. The beard is slowly coming back. It's nice and clean there, Larry. Welcome back.
The beard is about 105 days old now. It's getting where it needs to be. And dear God in heaven, thank you that we are back. Woohoo! Could not be more excited. This is going to be one hell of a year, boys.
Were you missing talking to Brad, myself, Dylan, when he's available?
Absolutely. Of course I do. Every now and then I shoot Andy a text just to see if he's actually doing anything that's making him money in life versus, just OCSC stuff. And you know what? It's just, it's good to be back. This has been a fantastic offseason. I can't wait. 3 weeks? Oh my God, that's like forever.
One other person helping us out in this episode for the full episode here, and that's one of our writers, DK. Welcome back. We've been here before. We're excited to have you. How are you feeling so far and heading into this new season?
Yeah, no, thanks for having me. I am incredibly excited, as it seems the vibe is around the podcast and the fans these days. I'm so excited that I can't even wait for the home opener. I will be driving up to Sacramento for the game on the 9th. So that is how hyped I am for this new season.
I believe you're part of the camping crew that's making their way up to Sacramento.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, for those that have been living under a rock or haven't been paying attention, preseason is in full swing right now. Orange County's already been playing matches in the preseason. Unfortunately, those matches have been behind closed doors, or at least behind closed fences. I guess fans can sort of see some of the stuff here and there. But we wanted to talk about these matches, so we figured out, hey, who better to bring us on or bring onto the show to help us? Because he's been there. He's been watching what's been happening. And that's the man you see on media stuff for the club on Twitter, Facebook, whatever else he's posted, Instagram, Edison LaCour. Edison, first time on the show, right? Hey, welcome. How you doing?
Yeah, one of those first time, long time situations, I believe, isn't it? Very, very happy to be here on the show. Thank you for having me. Let's talk some OCSC.
Let's talk some OCSC. So really, honestly, Edison, you're going to be the one that's going to be the star of this point of the show, because I believe many of us haven't really been able to see what's been happening with this team in the preseason. But give us your basic recaps of the matches so far. Or wait, Larry?
Before Edison gets there, what is that you are sporting on your chest, my friend? Is that some new Hummel OCSC kit that we're seeing there?
No kit. New staff quarter zips that we got. You're going to see all of us in the front office be rocking some of the new Hummel and OCSC. This is, like I said, the quarter zips. You can see the chevrons are a bit lower down here, coming across the sleeves here. So yeah, very, very excited for the new gear. And I believe all of our fans are going to be very excited about that as well.
Nice. So since Larry went there, instead of talking about the games really quick, I'm just going to ask you this, and I don't want to get you in trouble with your team, but How excited are you? Like, I'm sure you've seen some of the mock-ups, some of the designs, some of the things coming out from Hummel. How excited are you, and what kind of grade are you going to give what you've seen so far? You don't have to tell us what you've seen. Just give us a grade and how excited you are about it.
You know, I wish I could do that last part, but it's pretty lock and key. I haven't seen them yet myself. So, but I am very excited just based off of what Hummel has been doing around the league. I believe that Hummel is going to be a great partner for us moving into the future. I love what they've done with the training kits. I see that DK has got one of them back there in the background. And yeah, I think it's going to be a very, very good time, a very good partnership for OCSC moving forward into the future.
Perfect. Yeah, I think the fans are all excited about this. I think they're excited with what the potential is with Hummel instead of what we had, sort of the cookie cutter. Nothing against Adidas, but it was very Adidas, very, you know, what anyone I think could go probably buy online and customize themselves with a name, a number, a logo or something like that. So it's exciting to see what we're going to get on the kits. Hopefully we hear something about that very soon. Let's talk about the preseason. And I'm just going to start off right here with a comment from you. If you had to grade the team's performances in the preseason so far, where would you sort of put them? Would you think they're exceeding what was expected preseason, maybe still trying to figure out the kinks, or do they look like they're right on track in the preseason as to the final 3 weeks here?
You know, I'd say it's a bit of a combination of the last two that you said, where they're kind of finding their feet and, but still also at the same time of finding their feet, kind of working out some of the kinks, right? You know, in talking with head coach Morten Carlson, he's been very pleased with how the fitness levels of the team has been coming along. Some of the starters are starting to begin to play more minutes in the first team here. In the preseason games, most of them went more than 45 minutes in this most recent outing. And you know, they are very pleased with how they're coming along and their fitness levels in the preseason, which is, you know, the plan and what is the what's the point of the preseason, right? It's to get your legs underneath you and hopefully to escape also without any injuries, which has also been a big point of emphasis so far in this preseason, is bringing guys back healthy, but also keeping them healthy and getting them ready for March 9th against Sacramento.
All right, Edison. So I got a question for you. The team so far, you mentioned that we are returning most of our players, avoiding injuries. That's good. The only thing that we're missing so far in this preseason is that scoring thread and goals going on the scoreboard. I believe that, you know, it's a good thing to see the team not conceding goals, or at least the starting players. But who does the team think is going to be that next Milan Alaski moving into the 2024 season?
You know, it's hard to replace a guy like Milan Alaski, you know, a former Golden Boot winner and all that kind of stuff, now moving on to play with Nordsjælland. I think one of the great things about this team is that they're not necessarily looking for one guy to replace his production. They brought in quite a few guys and retained one guy, you know, who is known for being a bit of a goal scorer in Tomas Among, bringing him back, had 9 goals last season. Just almost hit that 10-goal mark. But also bringing in a guy like Ethan Zubak, who at this level has shown what he can do, formerly of LA Galaxy 2. I'll be very happy that he's going to be wearing our colors now and hopefully pouring in some of those goal-scoring numbers that he did with Los Dos here for OCSC. And another former LA Galaxy product in Cameron Dunbar. You know, we got to see glimpses of him last season, you know, with his pace and his technical abilities, his footwork on the ball, creating space for himself and for others. But, you know, he's also a guy that I think they're looking to kind of recreate or fill in some of those holes that's left behind by, you know, the club's all-time record goal scorer, which is a hard thing to do. But it's, I think it's good that they're not necessarily looking to one guy to fill that hole, because it'd be a lot for one person to do, but you know, they've brought in multiple people who can kind of take on that burden. And I think those guys are ready for it.
All right. So we know the general starting lineup, what it's going to look like. It's going to be very similar to last year. But we also brought in a lot of guys down the roster who are going to be fighting for those roster positions. Are there any ones that have really stood out to you so far in this preseason?
So one guy that stuck out quite a bit to me so far in the preseason has been one of the new players that we brought on, and that's Sofyan Jafal. He's played in the most recent two preseason matches, and he's very technical on the ball. He plays in that midfield, and he can, you know, begin the press, but he can also, you know, create space for, like I said, for himself and also for others. He's a, from what I've seen so far, he's a very creative player. And I think he's going to fit into this system that Morten Carlsen uses just fine.
So Edison, talk to us a little bit about, give us a little bit of game recap from what you've seen. What maybe in particular, thanks, Ray. That's almost kind of what I was going to ask. But tell us what you've seen that is maybe a little bit different this year versus what we saw last year.
That's a good question. I wouldn't say that there's actually two. I think the biggest thing that they brought in with this group, but not only with the group, but with the coaching staff, was continuity. So, I mean, they're trying some new things here or there where they can. And again, I don't want to, you know, get too deep into it and, you know, start revealing things that I shouldn't be. But I think you're going to find a lot of consistency and a lot of carryover. That was the message so far in this preseason, and just trying to, you know, stay consistent. And now that looking at what Morten Carlsen did with a short season last year, now he's got a full preseason to really even further kind of build upon his tactics the way that they like to play, you know, which is going to be their possession style team. They're very comfortable on the ball, and they'll wait for their moments to find their attacking moments. They're not really going to force anything, and they'll stop an opponent's attack, not only by having that stellar defense, like we mentioned when we re-signed Colin Shuttler and the back line with, you know, the captain, Marcus Nakeem, Dylan Powers, Ryan Dogman, Owen Lamb. They're one of the best defensive units in the league last year. And I think that it's trending to be more of the same, and at least it has been so far this preseason. And they're just kind of looking for that goal scoring touch, which will come as, you know, time comes along. I think most recently this LAFC 2 game, the scoreline really didn't show just how much they dominated that game for. They were just kind of missing that final touch in the final third. But it easily could have been 3-4-0 going into halftime, not even, you know, at the end of the match. So, which is, you know, again, like we said, it's the preseason. It's, you know, we're looking to kind of refine some of those finer details. And I think come the ninth, I haven't seen anything that would deter me from believing that this team could go on a run similarly to last year's team.
Awesome. I got one more for you, and it's kind of a couple of parts. Okay. Mm-hmm. Who leads the team in scoring this year? How many goals do they score? And how many points does OCSC put up in 2024?
Man, that is a good question. let's see. I believe 65 got us to second place last season, if I'm remembering correctly. I would say let's shoot. You always want to improve, right? So let's go 68. I'm going to say the goal scoring leader is Tomas Among, and he bags 13.
I have written it down right here on this little OCSC pad. You can see it right there.
All right. Hold me to it, and I hope they eclipse that point mark.
Come the middle of October, we will have a discussion sidelines, or maybe right back here on the podcast, and we will see how good you are.
Sounds good.
Hey, how's it going, Edison? One of the things that I wanted to ask, just because you're somebody who's down on the field, you get to talk to the players a lot, you get to talk to the coaches. One aspect that was always brought up last season was the chemistry of the squad, and how basically everybody had said it was one of the best chemistries that we had seen in the club. Of course, now that we have so many returning players, I'm sure that chemistry is locked in. But how do you feel those new signings are fitting in with the role and the squad and that kind of culture that was already built from last season?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great question, and it's only continuing to grow. I'd say that the guys that they brought in, you know, they brought in Sofyan Jafal, they brought in Charlie Asensio, Ethan Zubak, like a lot of them have, a lot of them have prior connections with each other, whether that was playing with each other on prior teams or against each other. I know that Sofyan and Charlie played against each other in the national championship game, way back when. So there's a lot of history between guys on this team who weren't there last year. That's kind of just made them gel, I believe, really, really quickly. The vibes have been very high around the locker room, which makes for a very fun time going to work and, being around that kind of environment. It's been really fun, and I think it's only going to improve as they get even more time together throughout the season.
Fantastic. Yeah, we can't wait to see how that all plays out on the pitch. One last question. With the offseason, it seemed there was a big focus on a lot of the young players and moving them up to their professional contracts. So how do you feel, Bryce Jamison, Joseph Buckley, Ashton Miles, and Duran are doing in regards of finding their own comfortability and confidence within this first team?
Yeah, I think that's another great point, especially when we come to a guy like Ashton Miles, right? He's the first guy to come up through the OCSC 2 Academy and earn a first team contract, first team full-time professional contract. We've had a couple of guys, beyond those two-way Academy and professional first team deals. But he's the first one to get a full-time professional contract, which is a really big moment for the club and obviously for Ashton as well. And I think he slotted in really, really well. He played 90 minutes in that first preseason game against LMU. And I believe he's played at least 45 in every preseason game thereafter it. And, he looks like he's slotted right in. He was kind of when Marcus didn't feature in that first game and he was playing out there at center back, they were really kind of looking at him to be a little bit more vocal and kind of take over to lead that back line from the center back line. And he's slotted right in. And, you wouldn't tell that he's been, like I said, with the first team for the past two seasons or so, kind of coming on an up and down role. But it's, he's someone who carries himself like a professional, and is someone who is wise beyond his years, put it that way, when it comes to being a professional. So I'd say Ashton and Bryce and Duran, both of whom played at the U-17 World Cup, Ben Barjolo, Nico Ruiz saw some time against LAFC too, as did Taj Eagleston. So that pathway, the OCSC too, to the first team, you can definitely see it. And guys are getting their minutes here in the preseason and trying to show, give Morten Carlsen and the coaching staff some tough decisions for the regular season.
So I have one more question based on the youth that we just brought up. So I believe it was Ashton Miles is the first ever Academy player to make the jump. I do not believe there have been any others so far who have signed a professional contract with Orange County or elsewhere. Who is the next one from that group to make the leap, in your opinion? And is there more than one who will be signing a contract by the end of the season?
That's a great question. I am not 100% sure, but if you had to ask my personal opinion, I would say it's another one of those longer tenured guys that have been in the OCSC 2 program a bit now. I'd say Nico Ruiz. He's a young forward who was on the USL Academy League Finals first team for his performance when OCSC 2 went down to Florida. But I also would say that Taj Eagleston has a shout as well, to potentially guys that I could see go on signing first team contracts, the both of whom play their roles very well and have been in training this preseason, you know, with OCSC 2 and occasionally with the first team when they bring guys up from the second team. But I'd say that those two are definitely two to keep an eye on.
All right. So I know that this next question needs no introduction. Our fellow co-host Dylan says it all the time, and I'm sure you've trained players, but you finally get to answer it yourself. What is your favorite vegetable and how do you prepare it?
You know, my favorite vegetable, I'd have to say is probably a carrot. I love some carrots. And preparing it, I don't really know if you could say that it's preparing it. I just pull some baby carrots right out of the bag, nice little side of ranch. That's as prepared, I guess, as it needs to be, if you ask me. So
yes.
I'd go with some carrots and ranch.
Offset our healthy food with unhealthy ranch. I love
exactly. That. You know, it's, you got to disguise it a little bit, right?
It's the only way to eat any vegetable.
Exactly.
That's the way to do it. Edison, if you open up your Spotify or whatever account you use to listen to music right now, what song's playing?
Well, I just got back from the gym, so I'd say probably like some Eminem. He's as classic as it can get, and as far as the gym goes, I don't know if there's anybody that gets the blood pumping quite as quick as a nice little Cinderella Man from Eminem, you know.
And what kind of exercises were you doing this evening at the gym, Edison?
Let's see. We did some chest and tries today. A good friend of mine once told me that Monday is International Chest Day. So I was like, all right, well, I can't let you down today. So that's what we did this evening.
Awesome. And do you have maybe a local business or restaurant or something you want to give a shout out to so our fellow listeners and co-hosts can maybe try it out if we haven't done so already?
Absolutely. Yeah, big fan of this question. I'd say a place you got to go check out. I just recently got a fresh trim from them. It is the Den Barbershop. They'll see you too, Larry. They do beards and all that kind of stuff. It's the Den Barbershop in Dana Point. A good friend of mine is a barber down there, and they run a great shop. So if you're ever in the Dana Point, they got a location in Laguna Beach as well. I would say that the Den is a place that you should check out if you're in need of a haircut.
There we go. Larry, you got to go get that beard trim. You got to go get a beard trim right there, man.
I get mine done there too, Larry. They do a good job, I promise.
I got a guy. His name is Wendy, and I trust her. There's only a few people I'm going to let touch this bad boy. And right now, it's her and her alone.
There you go. So, you need those people.
So, Edison, I want to just give you a chance to – because there may be people that are hearing you on our show, maybe they don't follow you or watch what's going on the social medias. Let the listeners know, like, what is it that you do for Orange County and how can they hear more from you or watch more from you in the future?
Yeah. Thank you. I appreciate that. I am the content and match day producer at Orange County Soccer Club. So I help run our social media team alongside our very good videographer and social media specialist, Irving Arvizu. He's one of the best in the business, and we do you know, various content videos, and we're going to kick the match previews back up again here soon once the regular season begins again, and so we're going to get those going, and you know, we're trying to elevate as much coverage as we possibly can with Irving. He allows us to do a lot of new things that we couldn't previously do in the future. So he and I, we're going to do our very best this season to try and bring you alongside OCSC, not only on the field, but a little bit off the field, and just try and help expose, you know, Orange County SC and its players and humanize them a little bit. You know, like, obviously we're all people too, and see, you know, kind of a glimpse into their lives and training and all that kind of stuff. So we're really doing our best that way. You can catch all of that. We are Orange County Soccer on Instagram, Orange County SC on Twitter. And you can go ahead. I follow, I'm most active on Twitter with at Edison LaCour on Twitter.
Yeah. And I apologize ahead of time for this upcoming season when Larry is photobombing most of your pictures, your videos, because he's sitting there always trying to find a way to be on the screen when he's sitting on the sidelines there with his phone getting images for our Instagram account as well. See, there
we got to give that beard as much airtime as we possibly can.
I could not agree more.
you bearded people stick together too well. I want to thank you out of sit for
without a beard, Ray. So, brother, come join us.
I shaved last night because my wife does not like the way it feels. My beard comes out with really needly stubble. So my wife does not like the way that feels when I try to give her a kiss. So I had to shave it.
Like that. You got to get past 10 days and you're good.
Yeah, no, for me, I promise you, 10 days for me is not good. Trust me, you can ask my wife. Edison, before this spirals down into a typical black hole here on the podcast, I want to thank you for joining us on this episode. Hey, we'll have you back on again in the near future. You can come chat with us more. We appreciate the insider insight that you are able to provide that we just act like we know. So thank you, Edison.
Guys, it was a pleasure. I appreciate you all for having me. And have a good rest of the show.
We're excited for the season.
Have a good one, Edison.
Looking forward to seeing you at the champ. We're going to go straight on. We had one guest. Let's go on to another guest who's waiting in the green room. And this is a gentleman that's been on this podcast multiple times. I believe now, correct me if I'm wrong, everybody, the highest tenured player here on the team now, Mr. Seth Casiple. First question I have for you, Seth. First, welcome back to the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
My first question is, I don't know if you've listened to episodes last season, but you got a lot of flack for your music taste from a lot of players. When we asked the question, who has the best and who has the worst taste in music, your name came up for both of those. Sometimes it was the you know, political answer. Oh, he's good, but he's maybe not. I don't know. What can you just explain? What music are you playing that is creating this divide in the locker room with the taste of music?
Probably just the music that I like, which isn't everyone's cup of tea, apparently, which if you can't handle the heat, stay out of the kitchen. You know, sometimes you miss the aux, but I just tell everybody, well, if you want it, then connect it. If you want to connect your phone, go ahead. But that means you can't watch videos on your phone. You know, the Bluetooth audio is going to come through the speaker. That's a fine. So I put on a radio and I put it in my locker and I go about my business. And I take requests all the time, but yeah, I mean, it's like, some guys don't like some of the classic rock stuff. A lot of guys aren't super into country, but I like mixing it up. I don't know. Sometimes hearing the same kind of like hip hoppy stuff. I don't know. Like sometimes I'll play jazz. That kind of doesn't go over very well, but it's a good start to the morning. You know, you don't know what you're going to find.
So you're busting out like the achy breaky heart first thing in the morning and the
today, I'll give Sofiane a shout out. He wanted some Frank Sinatra. So we played, started with Fly Me to the Moon radio. And it always shifts. We listened to Dua Lipa, Ariana Grande. Who else did we get in there? I'm trying to think if that's another, but yeah, so I just like to, to mix it up. Cause, I don't know. You just want to start the morning off good, get some good energy.
Well, here's the thing, right? If you don't take the initiative and go out there and play the music, I mean, Seth's going to do it. So players, I mean, if you want to get the music going, you got to get there super early, beat Seth to the punch, play some music. If not, don't complain. He beat you to it. He got the music going.
But I appreciate you guys. You guys gave people the courage to speak up, because now, so I've got some help from Cameron Dunbar, who I rate as a DJ. He's for sure playing some really good ones. So we kind of switch it off. But I don't mind the flack. Hey, if somebody hears something they like they never heard before, then I don't mind.
Well, and that's the amazing thing, right? You build this great chemistry with the team in the locker room. You could see it on the pitch, and you guys can sort of be open and honest with the music. You can joke about it a little bit and have fun. And I think every time we asked that question last season, everyone would crack up at it. I think some people were anticipating it. Let me ask you, Seth, for all the people in the locker room, other than you, who has the best taste in music, who has the worst?
Ooh, Marcus Nakim has a very, very good taste in music. He's got a very eclectic taste. He knows a lot of older music, which I think is I respect him for that. And then he knows a lot of the new music, so I like it a lot. The worst taste in music. That's a tough one, because That's tough. I honestly couldn't tell you exactly, but I don't know, like a lot of the young guys. So, I mean, I'm pretty old now. And so sharing a locker room with 18-year-old kids and hearing the jargon and sometimes listening to some of the stuff they've got on their headphones, I have no idea what's going on. So I'd say kind of a mix of them, Jay Buck, Ben and Ben Bargiolo and Bryce Jameson. Like who else would I really not know? Mostly those guys, which I like teasing them about. Ashton Miles. Yeah, it's pretty fun.
So I got to ask you this question because you sort of brought it up. When did you realize, you know, now as a soccer player, you're old. You're an older soccer player now. When did that come to your mind?
Oh, it's you guys aren't going to like it, but like 5 years ago.
It's a it's young just, man's game, right? It's a young man's game.
Yeah, I just kind of looked in the mirror one day and I just randomly thought like, oh, okay. There's some guys coming in that just, you know, maybe haven't gone to college or I graduated from college 4 years ago when I'm talking about school days. It's it comes at you fast.
Oh, I was saying who will go next, but I think it's Larry. Larry, I'm going to pass it on to you.
First of all, Seth, Ray did not introduce you properly, so I'm going to. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the show Orange County Soccer Club legend, freaking legend, Seth Casiple. Let's get that right next time, Ray. Know who you're talking to. You are a senior member of the team. And granted, I was 2 years out of college when you were born, so I got you by a couple. You ain't old yet, brother. Not even close. But you are a senior member of the team. And there's another senior member of the team who is no longer with the team, who, if I understand correctly, for all of your years as a professional, there's only two seasons where you haven't played on the team with him, and that's Brent Richards. Can you talk to us a little bit about your time with Brent, your relationship with Brent? What's it like not having Brent there this year after so many years of being together?
Brent Richards is one of my best friends. He is a phenomenal human being, compassionate, respectful, disciplined, hilarious. Yes, I was very fortunate to spend a large proportion of my career with him. He taught me a lot of things. We struggled through a lot of things together. We succeeded together. Just a special relationship to have with someone. And so on the topic of Brent Richards, he is an inspiration for me. And even though he's not here physically, he's with me every morning.
Nice. I have one other one for you, and I want to take you back to the Western Conference Finals against, who the hell were we playing? San Antonio? San Antonio. Ugo Okoli scores that goal. Everybody starts going nuts. Everybody's running in, and all of a sudden, I don't know if you even remember doing it, but you came sliding right through the camera. Do you remember this?
I do.
Somebody created a GIF of it. And I'm wondering if you can go back to that moment and if you can recall what is going through your head at that moment, because it's got to be one of the longest slides in the history of soccer. It was magnificent. Can you just maybe talk us through just a little bit on that?
I do remember this. I got a lot of videos from my family also say of like the TV and then just me kind of just, you know, sliding across it. I enjoyed it. I was happy that it came off so well. Sometimes they don't go that well, but we were fortunate that it was kind of sprinkling. I mean, just later in the year. So the dew, picks up for sure in the second half once the sun sets. And, I had actually hurt my foot earlier that year. So I was out for a large portion of that year, but was fortunate to get fit for the playoffs and was getting some minutes towards the end. So, just a rush of emotions and that's something that you dream of. You see it every day on TV, I think. So, I can tell you a couple of notable ones, but one that comes to mind is Didier Drogba in the Champions League final. He did one after scoring a header against Bayern that was just so good. And then Fernando Torres also has one when he played for Chelsea too. Like, when you know you can slide for a little while, you just kind of just run into it. And it's just like the slip and slide in the backyard. You lay down and that was fun. Yeah, it was a good one. I was like, oh, I'm kind of sliding for a while. I don't go too far.
It was beautiful. And there's nothing, I think I can speak for the entirety of the Orange County Soccer Club fan base. If we could see that again, sometime late in the year from you, it would just make the entire season entirely worthwhile. So we'll see you on the pitch then.
Yes, yes, thank you. I hope I can do it too. That'd be awesome.
Great to see you again, Seth. Question that I have for you is, you know, obviously, undoubtedly, the squad had an amazing second half of the season last year, you know, probably the best in the league. We were just on a run and it was fantastic to see and to watch. How confident are you that you guys can keep that momentum from the end of last season into 2024?
Very confident, really confident. I think this is one of the first times I've had a significant amount of returning players in the locker room, which is really cool. It's nice to see a lot of continuity already. It's offering different challenges and also pretty, pretty gratifying to not have a lot of new faces, but yeah, I mean, and when you ask me the question, honestly, my first thought is new year. Kind of want to move forward. Don't want to be looking backwards too much. It was a wonderful accomplishment, and we fell short of, you know, a couple of our goals, obviously, and so it's by no means a failure, but. The group so far, I'm really optimistic about. I think we added good pieces. I think we have good guys coming back. Just a matter of, like I said, keeping the head down, looking ahead, staying present. And I think that we'll be good.
That's great to hear. And just one last question. You know, obviously you had mentioned we have a ton of returning players, probably, you know, one of the best slots of returning players that we've had throughout the years that I've been watching, at least. But how important for you as a player and the rest of the squad was it that you got to see Carlson return for a multi-year contract?
Very important for me. I've really liked working with him. He's teaching me a lot, which is cool. I'm just learning more about me as a player, learning more about soccer in general, tactically. I mean, then also managing. He has handled a lot of situations really well, I believe. I have a good relationship with him. So yeah, him coming back definitely made it more appealing to stay.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and take the reins. Hello again, Seth. This Hello. Is, I believe, your 12th professional season by my count. But I think what's really interesting is last year was your most minutes played with Orange County in one season ever, and your most since, I believe, 2019 in Reno. You mentioned your injury history. What kind of changed over the last year, year and a half, to where you're playing more minutes than you were any other season with Orange County?
I don't know, to be honest. I mean, I guess I've been fortunate, I guess, like to have a pretty good idea about what my body likes, what my body doesn't. It's definitely a big goal of mine every offseason to physically improve. Somewhere that I'm not the most imposing person on the field, but so any advantage I can get, the off season is usually a good time to do it without so much load on the body. Especially that year you mentioned in Reno and last year, I have found that I definitely succeed most in teams where my role is really just more of a supporter. I'd like to make actions in games that are more impactful, but for the most part, I do a really good job of maintaining structure within a group and kind of just moving the ball from A to B. So I think that I found myself in a good role last year, and I'm hoping to be of use as much this year, obviously. But again, that's Carlson's decision. So I just try and show up and get to work. And in a couple of years, it has worked out, and I've played pretty well. So that's good.
All right. My next question for you is, you've been around a long time, obviously, as we've mentioned. I guess one of the things that, recent news aside, is the increasing level of competition in the USL. How has it really changed from when you first started back in your days, I believe, with the Timbers 2 to today? How has the level of difficulty or, I guess, play increase in the USL over those years?
Good question. Something that we talk about a lot, actually, the guys that have been around for a while and have seen what the league was like 6 or 7 years ago. compared to now, especially with, I mean, a good example is like the Norwegian guys that we got, Marcus and Ryan. They, I don't think that you'd be getting guys of that quality 6 or 7 years ago, or it would be a lot more difficult to convince them that coming here would be a positive decision for their careers. Whereas tactically, the games have gotten more clever, I'd call them. Like, so it's teams are realizing that being disciplined what can get you results, being organized, you know, being a group, teams are becoming a lot better at that. Clubs are also spending more money, both in salaries and in facilities. So teams are having strength coaches, teams are having gyms, teams are using a lot more resources to put out better products. There's a little bit of background, but I suppose like, so the another reason why I believe that the league has steadily gotten better is so like we recently unionized. And so now that there's just kind of more of a solid foundation for standards across the league, you're finding that maybe some of the teams that given a choice wouldn't meet those standards are now meeting them. And that, so those, that's creating more environments where better players are able to shine a little more. It just pushes the league a lot. It accelerates the league's evolution a little bit quicker, I believe, you know, from a player's perspective. I'm sure clubs may not want to hear that, but yeah, it's gotten exceedingly better physically, tactically. I mean, even fans, I think it's more exciting. I think the games are more exciting to come watch. I think that the quality is better. Players are faster. They're more dynamic. It makes for more entertaining soccer. So, I think that all of them together, to answer your question, is the soccer has certainly gotten better. The soccer has improved. And so the entertainment factor has improved and people want to come play in front of people.
All right. I got one more and I'll hopefully avoid the age question here, but you've played in a lot of different stadiums. And now that we're doing a lot of moving to the East Coast now with cross conference play, what's your favorite stadium you've visited so far over your career?
Oh, favorite stadium that I visited. Favorite stadium. So without thinking about it, I immediately think Sacramento, just because that's where I love to go play and they can pack it out. You know, I've played in front of 9,000-10,000 people there and it's a lot of fun. The Louisville stadium is very nice. Their stadium, I mean, it's obviously new, but, and so that really feels like, what I would say is like a European soccer environment when I walk into it. Played the Rio Grande Valley, RIP to, that stadium is really cool. That's, you know, it's soccer specific. Most of them are going to be soccer specific. Just, you know, getting fans all the way around the stadium and not having to deal with a baseball field or a track or something it's really nice. I guess I should probably get some flack for not saying the Great Park Championship Stadium, but that, I mean, that one's nice too. It is. We feel very comfortable there.
I will say Championship Soccer Stadium, although it's probably not the most grand and this amazing stadium, it's beautiful for its intimacy and for what it creates for the fans in our area. My biggest selling point when I talk about that stadium is any seat you get there is a great seat. You're gonna see and hear all the action at any seat in that stadium. And you can't say that about most sports in the area, which is pretty cool. So yeah. I won't hurt you for not mentioning that on all the other ones, because there's a lot of beautiful stadiums when it comes to soccer that you've played in. I have a question for you, and I'm going to try and avoid the political aspect of this question or anything like that, but there's been a lot of news recently about the Open Cup, MLS, and all that, you know, cluster mess going on with that. I want to ask you personally, what are your thoughts on the Open Cup as a player, as Seth Casiple? What are your thoughts on that? Is it something that you enjoy playing in? Is it something that you're motivated to play in? How does that all play out in Seth Casiple's world?
Yeah, I was just talking to Dunbar about that because both of our Twitter feeds are full of the mumbo jumbo that is speculation on, you know, all the whys, right? Everybody wants to know why, because we don't know what is happening. But for Seth Casiple, the Open Cup is exciting. I think the Open Cup is exciting. I love playing in it. I am I'm prideful of it. You know, I like the early rounds. You know, we play against other local teams that you could argue compete for like, what is that? I mean, you know, kind of supremacy in the region. And so I enjoy, I want to get out there and I want to beat them. Right. I want to have proof to say like, no, I play for Orange County Soccer Club. I play in the USL, right? Like I play a high level of soccer. So it gets me excited for that. And then you take it as it comes. And with the opportunity to play against MLS clubs, last year we played against Portland in Portland. What's that? I can't remember. Why can I remember what that stadium is called? But
Providence.
Yeah, Providence Park. Like, so getting to play there is amazing. Getting, you know, it's it provides a lot of opportunities, and there's so much randomness. Tournaments can be all the highs and the lows. I just think that it's really where you're going to get a lot of the like the soccer energy, that worldwide soccer energy is where the Open Cup is for me. So I love it. I want it. I want to play in it.
Yeah. And if you don't have the Open Cup, you don't get that amazing celebration with Bryce and Correa last year where they're leapfrogging over each other. I believe it was against Campo FC. Mm-hmm. You don't get the experience where I think there was over 100 Orange County fans traveling to what was then Bank of America Stadium mm-hmm. to face LAFC, which yeah. is a neat experience. I know there's maybe people in the MLS side that don't enjoy having to potentially travel to the Great Park, but I mean, it's the beauty of it. And I appreciate your honesty with that answer there, Seth. Let me ask you one question about Orange County Soccer Club here. Out of all the incoming players that are not part of that core that returned, who has been surprising you from what you've seen from them in the training sessions? Is there one or two players that are really standing out in your vision of, man, these guys are going to help us this year?
I mean, honestly, I would hesitate to use the word surprise, I guess, if that would be, you know, politically correct, but you don't know what you're going to get. And I'm aware that maybe coming into a group like ours, which is pretty close, I think we're a good team. And also returning so many guys, I can understand why it might be a little intimidating coming into a locker room like that. So I'm happy to see that guys, I hope I don't forget anybody. Yeah. Zubac, Sorto, Charlie Asensio. Is there any, Sophie Ann, like the, just to see them step in and have personality and express themselves and you know, and want to make it an impact or want to compete is a good thing for all of us. I think that it's only going to make us better. And I think that they saw that it's a healthy place to come in and try and earn a spot. So really all of them have been awesome. I think that they've put their head down. They've wanted to work. They've gotten right in. And we'll see what happens.
Awesome. One last question for you. For the fans making their way out to the stadium this season, what should they expect out of Orange County Soccer Club, the players, out of Seth? What should they be excited to come to the Championship Soccer Stadium for in 2024?
I would be happy if after a game, win or lose, a fan said, you know what, this is my first time here and I had a blast and it just looks like you guys just never gave up. And so I think that that would be, like, I think that if, you know, if we do that, if we stay in till the very end of every single game, you know, I think that we're going to pull ourselves out of holes. I think that we're going to put in a lot of goals against teams if we continue to push towards the end and keep that level. Yeah. So I think that's what people should be excited to come and watch is a team that you are going to get 90 minutes of people wanting to run and new guys coming onto the field, wanting to run, wanting to score, wanting to work. I think that that's what they're going to get.
Awesome. I'm going to just ask my fellow co-host any other last questions before we let Seth enjoy the rest of his evening. Going once, going twice.
I'm happy to answer Karen K's question. She's just to help her out. She's
really... There we go. Hey, Seth, yeah, go here's for the it.
Thing. Sometimes we will take fan questions and we will ask those fan questions. And I was actually going to put in our little private chat, hey, do we want to ask this question? And then there was that other comment about the dude's had 12 questions about his age. So I decided to back off of it. But you know what? Please go for it. Answer.
To recover, not so much sleep. Sleep hydrate, sleep and hydration for recovery. You know, you're going to get hit by a wall regardless. But more importantly, preparation. So, especially if you're flying, it's hydration like at least 24 hours before the flight. And then, you know, move in around, like I like to get into a pool, when we fly, just to kind of get the body going, high, the altitude, like the air, the concentration of air doesn't do things good for the body. And it takes a lot of time for your body to get used to that. So before, what is it? Magnesium, I guess there's different kinds of magnesium. I learned that this year. That's kind of crazy. But so it's magnesium, it's hydration. And then it is, if we're playing on Saturday, then by Thursday night, trying to put like a good amount of food in you, whether it's whatever you're comfortable with. Like I don't necessarily eat a ton of carbs, but like I'll just have like a big meal and then kind of like taper down from there, because I don't like to play super heavy and like feel like I'm really full. But yeah, definitely the prep is what I'm mostly focused on. And then the recovery, you know, when you're on away trips and you got a flight early on in the morning, sometimes you want to go out and have a couple. So get ready for next week.
All right. Then let's go to that question. Then, you know, after the game, if you're talking about having a couple, what is your go-to couple?
Go-to couple. That's gonna be funny. I like Budweiser. I call Bud Heavy because it's not Bud Light. And then a Dark and Stormy. That's kind of been for about a couple of years now. That's been my go-to.
All right, I'm an old guy. I don't know what the hell a Dark and Stormy is.
Rum and ginger beer.
Oh,
interesting. All right, I might have to try that. I like rum. I don't know quite like ginger beer, but hey, I might have to try that on the advice of Seth. I'll try something like that.
Okay. It's a good one. I concur, Seth.
They're good. And they're, I don't know. It's just kind of, it's one of those things that like, you don't really think about it. You know, you don't have one for a while, then you hear somebody order it and you're like, actually, that sounds,
is it just, good. You just use like a cheap rum. You don't use a really crazy expensive rum. It's just a cheap rum.
No, just dark rum.
Okay, cool. Good to know. Seth, I appreciate you taking some time with us this evening. For this episode and speaking to us, and we're super excited. I'm going to speak for all Orange County Soccer Club fans. I think we're all excited for this upcoming season. It sounds like you are, and it sounds like the players are excited for this upcoming season as well. We're looking forward to some amazing things, and hopefully we're going to see some great things from Seth, from the team, and maybe potential lifting of some sort of trophy by the end of 2024, right?
We should hope so.
Awesome. Once again, thank you as always, Seth, for joining us on this podcast, and we appreciate it, and we'll talk to you again soon.
Yeah. Thank you guys for having me. See you guys out there.
Thank you.
Awesome. It's there's really no games to talk about at this point. So it's just fun to have someone like a Seth Casiple on. You just feel like you're having a conversation with a pal. He's so open. I know there was, I'm going to just call you guys out. This is not to be mean, but there was like chatter in the background. Do we ask about the Open Cup or should we not? And I'm like, you know what? Seth's a great guy. I'm just going to ask it in a way. I'm not going to ask him to take a side. I just want to find out, does Seth like the Open Cup and what are his thoughts on what it means and stuff like that? So I thought that was really good discussion to get there.
My thinking on it was, is, you know, let's be careful that we don't do something that might get him into some kind of hot water if he says the right thing, the wrong thing, etc. So sometimes even I can try to be politically correct.
here's the thing, right? If we had Bryce Jameson on that and we're talking to him, I'm definitely not going into that question with him. Seth is someone that is experienced talking to the media. You could tell he's composed. He knows how to answer, and I figured Seth would be able to answer it appropriately and give some honesty on it as well. So that's the reason I decided it's okay to ask that question. I took that lead and said, let's just ask it. Let's do this really quick. Before we wrap anything out, I'm going to ask you all each a question. We're actually going to do two rounds of questions. Then we'll do our random thoughts. We'll be done with this. I want to get a quick take from each of you on your thoughts. Like, what's exciting you about this upcoming season? And I'm going to start with you, Brad. What is exciting you about 2024 for Orange County or just for the USL in general?
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to answer two part. For Orange County, I know this is kind of the obvious tip of the tongue answer. 10 out of 11 starters are returning to this team. This team was finishing second in the regular season last year off, I believe it was 58 points. I know Edison said something different earlier, but this team definitely finished on a high. You can tell just from Edison, you can tell from Seth, they're still confident that they're still the same team as last year and can only build on that for this year. For the USL as a whole, you know, I thought I would never say this, but I'm excited to see what Las Vegas is bringing with their new ownership and Jose Bautista. Brent Lashbrook is finally out. The signings that they have rapidly made over the last couple weeks. This team is going to be a lot more competitive, and away days to Vegas are going to be a lot more difficult for most teams. And definitely going to look forward to just not only Vegas being better, but just the parity in the league. There's a lot of movement of good players, but a lot of newer good players coming to the USL as a destination. And you're going to find in the next couple of years, the best USL teams, if the Open Cup stays a thing, are going to consistently start beating the worst of the worst in the MLS. That gap has narrowed greatly.
Larry, what's exciting you entering this season?
I'll echo Brad about, you know, all of these returning players. I've been coming to games since 2018. I've been season ticket holder since the start of 2019. There are more returning players on this team, maybe than in all the years combined, it feels like. So seeing all these guys back and seeing what a good, good soccer team this turned into, you know, after that first 2.5 month stretch, I am really looking forward to seeing this an entire season under Coach Morton. I am looking forward to the post Milan, as much as I love the guy and watching him score goals, but I'm looking forward to the post Milan era to see how Orange County fills that hole. It's a huge hole. 43, however many goals it was in 2 years. That's a big number in this level of soccer. So I'm looking forward to seeing how the team moves forward from that. And man, I'm just looking forward to being back on the sidelines game after game and hoping that I can maybe, you know, make a little bit better content that's a little bit more entertaining. I'm working and I'm still learning. So I'm just looking forward to getting back out to the games.
DK, what's exciting you the most entering the season?
Yeah, I mean, I think as soon as last season ended, a ton of us talked about how the one thing that we wanted and hoped the most for in this offseason was Morten Carlsen coming back. So him back on the reins, I think, had me hyped immediately about what we could see from the 2024 season. And another thing is, you know, last year's stadium deal that we got. I think that's going to change the environment in the stadium. I think not just this year, but the next few years, we're going to see this club, this fan base, this culture that we've seen grow over the past 10 years grow faster than we ever have. And I'm really excited for what that entails and to be a part of it.
Yeah, my excitement is coming from more sellouts. I'm anticipating a ton of sellouts this season. I think that is part of, you know, what's happened with the stadium deal, with social medias, with the growth of this team and the success this team has had. I think that's going to be amazing. Next, really quick, I want to ask you, and I'm stealing this. For those that don't know, I listen to sports talk radio quite a bit. I'm stealing this next little segment. This might stick. It might not. Depends how it goes. I'm going to ask you all this. What did you learn on this episode? I'm going to start with you, Brad. What did you learn? I'll go first just so you can hear what I'm going to say. What I learned today is that Seth does not go to Olive Garden for all-you-can-eat pasta before he plays matches because he doesn't like to load up on those carbs. He just eats a hearty meal, but it's not the pasta from Olive Garden all-you-can-eat. Brad, what did you learn on this episode?
Oh, boy, I wish I knew this question at the beginning so I'd listen a little harder. Just kidding. No, you know, just I'm really excited just hearing Edison talk about the pipeline of the future and the players, Barholo, Ruiz, all of them just looking forward to who signs next and eventually, you know, who signs away next to a different team in the league or in the world.
Awesome. What did you learn this episode, Larry?
Hey, I learned about a new drink, a highball cocktail made with dark rum and ginger beer served over ice and garnished with a slice of lemon. But I can't remember the damn name of it because I'm old and I forget shit.
Stop. Dark and Stormy.
Dark and Stormy.
You forget stuff, Larry. You forget stuff. Where's producer Andy? You got to get the bleep on there before he hits the streams. DK, what did you learn this episode?
I'm going to have to piggyback off of Brad a little bit in regards of what Edison answered, that it really seems like these young players that are coming up from the two team that signing professional contracts are really stepping up and holding their own with, you know, all the starters that we had last season. And I think that's fantastic. In relation to that, that apparently all the young guys, according to Seth, have the worst taste in music, which I feel like from a lot of us probably isn't too surprising. So
there we go. Random thought time. Quick random thoughts. I'm going to go reverse order DK. Actually, I won't go reverse order. I'm going to save Larry for last because I think he wants to go last, right? So we'll go to DK first.
Yeah, I mean, random, kind of not random, but for everybody listening, the CLC County Line Coalition will be having their last off-season meetup this Saturday at the Harp Inn in Costa Mesa at 6 o'clock. We would love to get as many people out there. Let's get even more hyped about this season that's coming. And not only that, but the Harp Inn is where we watch away games. So come by, check out the area, and let's make a great culture this season.
Brad, random thought.
All right. So I got a new co-host the day after our last episode. In between now and then, this is the woman that Larry cuts his beard. This is Wendy. No joke. this is Wendy the dog. She's wearing a Hurricanes jersey to match me, and she's just the sweetest little angel.
Perfect. Yeah, I got two dogs as well, Lily and Roxy. They're not with me, though, right now, so I can't show them off. Random thought for me is now I'm a fan of two Zubaks when it comes to sports. One plays for Orange County Soccer Club, and the other plays for the LA Clippers, Ivica Zubac. Ivica Zubac. That's how you say it. Ivica Zubac. So it's interesting. I never thought I would cheer for two Zubaks. Larry, your random thought.
Bear with me for just a minute, guys, okay? On New Year's Day, I was sitting in my recliner and I was stretching, had my arms above my head, had my hand over here on my chest, kind of helping out with stretch. And I felt a lump in my right breast. Now, not typically a big deal because only 1 in 800 men get breast cancer. However, in my family, my grandmother, my great aunt, my mother, both of my sisters, two of my 40 plus year old cousins, all have breast cancer. As it happened the next day, I just happened to have a doctor's appointment for something else. And I had the doctor take a look. He immediately said, let's get a biopsy. Let's get a mammogram, or let's get a mammogram. Let's get an ultrasound. Nothing came back on the mammogram and the ultrasound. Everything looked blank. I insisted on them doing a biopsy because after talking with my oldest sister, nothing was ever found in any of the people in my family via mammogram and ultrasound. It was always found in a biopsy. So roughly a week and a half ago, I had a biopsy. Thank goodness that everything came back negative and I am perfectly healthy. So hallelujah for that. My random thought is not random at all. My random thought is be aware, be conscious of your bodies. I don't care how old you are, how young you are. Be aware of any changes that might be occurring because I never thought about stuff like this in my life. And now all of a sudden, being in my mid-50s, I have to think about it more and having this scare come up. You know, 5 or 6 weeks ago, it made me very conscious. So I just want to tell everybody else out there, be conscious, be aware, check for things. If you see something that doesn't look right, a skin discoloration, whatever it happens to be aware. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that, Larry. And yes, I agree. Be aware of your body and any changes and get them looked at if necessary. I want to say, we're looking forward to an awesome 2024. Thank you to all of our listeners that have listened live or that are listening in the future on podcast form. I want to thank all of my co-hosts for the evening, Brad, DK, Larry, our guest, Edison, and Seth. They were awesome. Also want to just give a shout out to our co-host that wasn't here tonight, Dylan. He was hoping to make it here. Apparently he was feeling a little under the weather, so he couldn't make it on. But he did want to share that he's pretty stoked about this season. He's excited about it as well. So we're looking forward to hear from him. Hopefully next week he'll be back. With that said, go Orange County. This is the Orange and Black Soccer Cast, and we're out.